For those of you who are familiar with the history of this event, for many years, we've had a prize that we've given out to an entrepreneur, and we will have that prize that we've given out for almost seven years now as the next one. But this prize that we're going to give out right now actually got introduced last year. So as Chancellor Jones said, things that are valued move forward during a pandemic, and this is definitely one of those areas where we saw a unique opportunity to partner with another company in Central Illinois to recognize a different type of entrepreneur. So I'm going to call Carl Barnhart to the stage. Oh, he's here. There he is. So Carl is the Executive Vice President and Chief Marketing Officer of Brandt, and he is here to give out the Glen G.B. Brandt Prize for Ag Entrepreneurism, which is actually from the Brandt Foundation. So Carl, if you want to come on up.
We're actually going to give this out together, Laura. So, but
you have the check.
We've got a big check. Okay. Who doesn't like to get a big check? So I've had this date on the calendar circled for a number of months because we are getting to hand out a big check, and you know that's cooler than selling fertilizer or anything that I have to do in my day job. So I want to take you back, though, before we hand out this check. I want to give you a little bit of why we're handing out this check. Take you back to 1953. Our founder at Brandt was just a young farm boy back from the Merchant Marines who was trying to figure out how to feed his family. And as we're talking about entrepreneurism, he was in a situation where he had to be entrepreneurial. He had to figure out how to feed his family because the farm wasn't going to be able to do it. And as he looked around and he looked for ideas and he thought about, well, how am I going to do this? There was this thing called anhydrous ammonia that was floating around. And he didn't know why, he didn't have a technology background, but you know, the farmers who applied this all of a sudden got much bigger yields than if they didn't. Back in 1953, I wasn't here, but I'm told the average yield was 50 bushels an acre. 50 bushels, imagine that today, 50 bushels an acre. But if you use this anhydrous stuff, you could get 100 bushel an acre. So Glenn, GB, you know, he's our GB. He put this little pitch together. Didn't know why, but if you use this stuff, you'll get 100 bushels an acre. And he was fervent in his belief, and he sold, and he worked on supply, and he worked on his neighbors until he built a business out of it, a business that today is in 49 states, 80 countries around the world. We're on about 1.3 million acres here in Central Illinois, and we have 800 employees scattered around the world. That's entrepreneurism. Unfortunately, as most of you know, we lost GB a couple years ago during the middle of the pandemic. We lost him at 94 years old, and we miss him every single day. And we want to honor that legacy. We want to honor that guy when he was 26 years old, out there trying to sell his neighbors on 100 bushel an acre for some magical reason. So we put together the GB Prize for Ag Entrepreneurism last year. We gave away $10,000 last year. We're gonna give away this nice big fat $10,000 check this year, and we're gonna do it again next year, and we'll just keep on doing it because we get to honor Glenn's legacy. So last year we gave it to Will Glazik, who is a wonderful farmer from just up the road, and he used it in his vodka business, which I know Glenn would absolutely love that idea, that we gave it away to a vodka farmer. Let's just call him a vodka farmer. So today we get to give it to somebody else. So Laura, do you want to do the honors, and I will do the check?
So we're really excited to announce the winner of the 2022 Glen G.B. Brandt Prize for Ag Entrepreneurism is Matt Riggs of Riggs Brew Company. So Matt, I see you out there. Come on up. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
Here you go.
I've always wanted to hold a big check like this. This is like, that's so cool.
So if, for those of you who are from, how many of you have been to Riggs? Okay, lots of hands up. So many of you have been to Riggs and many of you have drank Riggs beer, but many of you not understand the actual story behind the company and the amount of energy that has gone into this product and actually its ag roots. And so I think that's really what we're here to celebrate is, yes, it's great to celebrate the wonderful facility that brings people together and is the source of many celebrations, but I think what we're really recognizing today is the ingenuity that you have brought to brewing and to ingredients that are going into your product. So Matt, please give us tell us a little bit about what you do and what brought you here today.
Maybe a round of
applause. Thank you so much. And thanks to the Brandt Corporation, the foundation. I've already picked out the farm's getting a new grain cleaner. It'll be an old grain cleaner, but it'll be new to us. It's something that we've contracted out for years. And we're going to be able to bring it in-house, and that's going to help us keep a little more margin and give us some more flexibility on processing our brewing grains that we grow. So for those of you who don't know, I was born and raised on a farm in the southeast corner of the county. My family's been farming down there since 1874. We're not a big farm. We farm 316 acres, which is why I needed to do something different rather than just chase scale. My brother and I had the idea over probably several beers in the machine shed many, many years ago that it'd be really cool to be able to vertically integrate what we can grow on our farm into all the way to the end consumer. And it's taken us a while to get there, but that's what we do at Riggs Beer. It's actually a very simple process. If you zoom out far enough, we grow, we still grow a fair amount of, corn and beans for the commodity market, but we grow specialty corn. We grow wheat and barley. Those three crops we then vertically integrate into our beer, and then we sell the beer throughout central Illinois. Pretty basic idea, but if you can imagine technically when you zoom in, that's pretty challenging. Growing barley in Illinois is challenging by itself, but then having it be the quality that it needs to be to make a good beer, there's a reason why not a lot of people are doing it, because there's a lot of technical hurdles. I purposely didn't prepare any comments going into this morning, because I kind of wanted to hear what everybody else was talking about, and it's fun because there are so many things that directly relate to my struggle to try to find, you know, opportunities in the world of challenges out there that line up with everybody else's. Couple of those real quick, you know, fertilizer costs. We talk about lowering inputs if we possibly can. Sometimes it helps to use your small scale to your advantage. And one way that a small family farm can do that is side dressing. You know, that's a practice that's fallen out of favor by the big farms. Being a small guy, we can actually cover some acreage side dressing and cut costs a little bit that way. And especially in a year where we're seeing some pressure on that side, on the input side. Thinking outside the box, also, you know, quick shout out to Professor Moose, who's somewhere here. His really neat low oil corn variety allows us to cut out an entire processing step that other brewers that want to use corn in brewing, they have to give away margin to somebody else who has to process that corn that'll give them a lower oil ingredient, because corn has fairly high oil. Well, one way you can capture some of that back, thinking outside the box, several years ago I just Googled low oil corn, and Professor Moose's lab was the first result in Google. There was no commercial use of this ultra low oil corn. They just kind of kept doing it as part of a very old experiment, and I thought, hey, why not give this a try so that we can get rid of the de-germing process that I'd have to lose margin to, and we'll just vertically integrate that grain and rely on its natural low oil content to oil can kind of damage beer in certain ways, so we want to keep that low. So that's another example of don't always attack the problem from the same, you know, from one angle. come around and hit it from the other side, and a lot of times the solution can be very intuitive, and it's very clear that, yeah, that's also a good way to do this. One other thing I wanted to mention real quick, we're here in Central Illinois, so many of you probably don't know this, but the U.S. had its smallest barley crop in the last century this year, in 2021. The smallest barley crop in 100 years. Down 40% from 2020, and that's due to having a lot of heat and dryness in the main barley growing region up in Montana and the areas around there. One thing that this changing climate is doing is that it's given us more terrible variability in weather. We know that, right? If you asked farmers 10 years ago, was climate change real? I asked farmers 10 years ago if they thought that, and most said no. I don't know a farmer today that will tell you that it's not. The last 10 years of having really wet years, year in and year out here, has changed everybody's mindset on that. Everybody knows it's happening. It's impossible to deny. The other thing, lost my train of thought here. The other thing that climate change is doing here locally is allowing is actually kind of a bit of an opportunity for me as a brewer and farmer. It's given us warmer weather, more warmth on the beginning and the end, and more moisture, more dependable moisture in the middle of the growing season, which has actually made it pretty. We've done this several years in a row now where we've had small winter brewing grains that we get in October, get established. We actually can harvest those crops early enough that we get a double crop of soybeans in there. We get some moisture in July and August, more moisture than we used to in the past. Those soybean stands are really good. I'm getting double crop years now with wheat or barley and then soybeans afterwards that probably before climate change would fail much more often than what they're failing now. We've also, the farm's able to make a little bit more money because of that that challenge. We're able to capitalize on that. And we've also got essentially, in a way, a cover crop down for a lot of the year. I've got winter wheat or winter barley that's holding nutrient and holding soil there. So maybe just a couple examples of how in at Riggs Beer Company and my family's farm, we're able to kind of take some challenges and find a silver lining. And thanks again, everybody. And we'll put this to good use on a grain cleaner, I promise you. Yeah.
Thanks so much to the Brandt Foundation. Thank you, Carl, for your support of this award. Thank you so much to Matt and your family and for all that you do. We also want to thank our partners who helped to provide nominations for this award. So Adam Davis, I know I saw you earlier. There you are. So you're 2 for 2 now in nominations for this award. So if you want to get this award, talk to Adam. He just wrote a fabulous nomination. But really what this award also represents is collaboration. And I think a lot of us have talked about that earlier, is collaboration between industry, between academia, between growers, etc. And that's really what we're seeing, and the proof is in the pudding. So congratulations, and thank you very much to both of you. Thank you.